Hi all, I'm going to be introduce the concept of regression analysis and its computations to you. So before going to the regression analysis, just I'm going to be highlight the difference between the regression as well as the ANOVA. So we already know the ANOVA. For doing ANOVA, we need a two variable we need. One is called independent variable, that we may use the term as a normal factor. So if you have more than two or more than three or more classification in the categorical variable of independent variable, we can use the ANOVA. The condition to apply ANOVA, we need one independent variable, minimum three categories needed. In the case of dependent variable, it should be continuous nature. So that is why we are using the ANOVA. These are some of the assumptions while doing ANOVA. But see here, for checking the significant difference among the three groups, for the diagrammatically we are using the box plot graph. So in this we have found that the C group having lot of deviations, or there are lot of variabilities that compared to the other groups. So for this we are using ANOVA. But when we use the regression, in the sense, the same way we need independent variable and dependent variable in the case of regression analysis also. But in the case of independent variable, continuous predictor. So it means that the independent variable should be a continuous nature. We may use the term predictor as an independent also. The second variable is nothing but our dependent variable. That should be as a continuous nature. So I'm talking about the regression and the linear regression. Actually, if you go deeply about the regression, we found more number of regressions based on the types of the data, based on the number of independent, based on the shape of the curve. So it will be differ. But here I may focus on the linear regressions as well as the ANOVA. So we already discussed about the ANOVA. But in the case of regression analysis, independent variable should be continuous nature, and dependent variable is a continuous nature. It means that it will be integral or ratio scale. But how we can be check the regression analysis by using the graphical representation? Since we can go with scatter diagram. In this scatter diagram, in the correlation set, we are discussing this kind of table, the scatter diagram. But here the regression equation or regression, we are going to find out this straight line equation only. So this straight line equation is nothing but the average relation between the variable x and y. That's only we are going to found from this kind of regressions. Now I move to the correlations as well as the regression. So there is this little bit difference among between the correlation and regressions. In the case of correlations, we need a x and y, but here there is no need to be take assumptions that x is independent variable, dependent variable. In this case of the correlation, we are going to check the commonness or the association between the two variables only. So the association or the commonness, it may be a positive correlation or a negative correlation that we already discussed in the past classes. But in the case of correlations, we are going to find with the use of the scatter diagram, the correlation, we know the Pearson product moon correlation, rank correlation, pi coefficient, biserial correlation, lot of coefficient correlations are there. But the basic difference between the correlation as well as the regression, the correlation, it may useful for to find out the relationship. In the relationship, in the sense, we are going to find out the strength and the magnitudes, how much the magnitude values represent the strength of the correlation. The sign symbol, if you found the plus symbol, it's called the positive correlation. If you get the negative symbol, it's called negative correlation. Normally, the correlation value is some kind of magnitude value with sign. That is called correlation. But in the case of regression, we are going to find out the regression equations. The difference between the correlation regressions, here we need a causing variable as well as the effective variable. If you know the value of x, we can easily predict the value of y. Otherwise, we can easily find how the x is making the contributions significantly, how much it will be giving the contributions in the y. So in this way, we have to easily find out the regressions. Well, this is way the correlation and trivial regression to be different each other. This diagrammatic representation also, it will be emphasize the difference between the correlation and regression. In this example, see this case of correlation, the relationship, it may x to y. So sometimes we are not intently take x is independent variable, y is a dependent variable in the case of correlations. So we may be keep it anything is independent dependent, and also we are not much focused on the which is an independent variable and dependent in the case of correlation. But in the case of regression, we have to look on which is a predictor variable, which is an outcome variable. So that kind of things we have to come for conclusion before attempting the regression equations. So it means that the cause and the effect we can easily find out from the regression. If you know the value of x, we can easily predict the value of y. So otherwise, if you know the value of the independent variable, we can easily predict or we can easily find out the value of y with the use of the existing variable of x. In the case of correlations, it may move together. See, this case x tends to y, so it may go. So already we know the correlation type, it may be positive correlation or negative correlation. If x is increased, y also increases, in the sense called positive, or x is decreased, y also decreases, called positive correlation. In the different manner, if x is increased, y is decreased, or x is decreased, y is increased, then it's called a negative correlation. These things we know. But in the case of regressions, it may be positive or negative, because actually the regression is the higher level of the correlations only. But here we are going to find out the value of y with the value of x. So that kind of prediction may happen. But in the case of correlation, this interchange property may satisfy. It means that f of x comma y is called f of y comma x. It's nothing but suppose I found r x comma y. So if I know the value of r x comma y, there is no need to find the value of r y comma x, because both the values are same only. So the correlation of x and y is equal to correlation of y and x only. But in the case of the regression, it not be say, it cannot be interchange, and data represent in a single point. Actually, each point it represent the data in this case of correlation. But here in the regression, we are going to find out the average relation between the two variable x and y with the use of the state only. Actually, in the regression, the main intent is to find out the equation, the straight line equation only. This is the way the correlation regression to be defined. Normally, the regression type is to be differ based on the three matrices. The first matrix is the number of independent variables. So, in some cases, only one independent variable or more than one or two independent variables may be there. So, based on the number of independent variable, the regression type may be differ. Suppose if you are taking only one independent variable, one dependent variable, it should be a continuous nature, in the sense we can use the simple linear regression. In the case of two independent variable, only one dependent variable, we can adopt the multilinear, but the curve should be in a linear mode. That is called number of independent variable. So in the case of regression, it may be different from the shape of the regression line also. We already discussed about the linear regression and curve linear also, correlation, when you discuss about the correlation. If the straight line is coming to straight line mode, we can go with the linear regression. If it comes a curve nature, if the distributions come as a curve nature or curve linear or the polynomial base, we can go with a different kind of regressions. Then finally, the types of dependent variable. So based on this one, also the regression type may be changed. For example, we already know this case of measurement, nominal, ordinal, interval ratio. If nominal or ordinal, we can adopt the other kind of regression. If the dependent variable, it is in the interval or ratio or continuous form, we can do, we can calculate other kind of regression analysis. So based on the types of different variable, we have to change the regression computation things also. Therefore, the three matrices is very important to select, to identify the exact computations or exact formula to find out the regressions. The first thing I'm going to talk about the linear regressions. What is a linear regression? Linear regressions establish the relationship between the dependent variable and one or more independent variable using the best fit state line, also known as the regression line. I already mentioned that the linear regression having the two, one is called simple linear, other one is called multiple linear. In the case of only one independent, one dependent in a continuous nature, then we can use the simple linear. If it is two or more independent variable, only one dependent, in the case we can use the multilinear. Sometimes we may call the linear regression as a ordinary least squares or least linear least square. So this is a formula we are adopting. The main intention of to doing a linear regression, we are going to find out the straight line equations. So thus we already know the straight line equation. The schools level also we find that is called y equal to ax plus b, that formula. The next regression is called logistic regressions. So in the case of dependent variable, if the dependent variable is in a binary nature, it means a categorical variable like 0, 1 or true or false or yes or no format, we can go with this kind of logistic regression. So I hope you understand. In the case of linear regression, the dependent variable should be a continuous nature. But in the case of logistic regression, the dependent variable should be in a categorical, be a binary. So in this condition, we can use the logistic regression. In the case of polynomial regressions, we already discussed about the matrices. The three matrices based on the regression and that's made decided. But in the case of polynomial regressions, the best fit is not a straight line. Rather than the curve fits to the data points. The curve, the scores may be scattered in the nature of curve based. If you find out this kind of curve based scattered happened, we can go with the polynomial regressions. This diagram shows the exact picture about the polynomial regressions. The next one is called stepwise regressions. While you're doing the SPS analysis, this kind of things like a forward, backward regression analysis and all. But if you have more than two or more independent variable, we can use this kind of stepwise regressions. But it will be good while you're using the SPS analysis. What is the advantage? It automatically is taking the independent variable. It's like a rotating manner. It may find out the regression, the relationship among the independent variable, dependent variable, without no human intervention. It's automatically may selected the independent variable and dependent variable. The finally give the output for us. That is for stepwise regressions. The next regression is called rich regressions. So when we use the rich regression, in the sense when the data suffers from multicollinearity. For example, in the case of two or more independent variable, but two or three more independent variable, it will be correlated highly with each one. There is a chance for multicollinearity happen. That time we can use this kind of rich regression equations. The same way, there is another linear regression is called as a lasso regressions. What is the lasso regression? It means least absolute string case selector operator. It is the alternative form of the rich regression also. When we can use this kind of thing, in the sense the estimated coefficient swings more towards zero, which could be possible using a rich regressions. That time this kind of thing should be more beneficial for us. Short form, we are using the term as a lasso. The next one is called elastic net regressions. So this is like hybrid of the last two regression. It's nothing but lasso and rich regression, which combines the linear L1 and L2 penalties of 2R and is preferred over the two methods for many applications. Further, this should be good. So I hope you understand the different types of regressions and its assumption too. Just I'm going to be compile the entire thing in a single chart. While using a simple linear regressions, this is a condition we have to look on it. The independent variable only one independent variable, it should be interval or ratio. The dependent variable interval or ratio, it means a continuous nature. So in the case of linear, in the case of the regression, the main aspect is that the dependent variable always one. So in all the cases of the, if you want to do a regression, basic assumption only one dependent variable, then only we can go with this kind of regression equation. If you have more than two dependent variable, you cannot be used this kind of regression. We can think about the multivariate analysis. So the main important assumption that dependent variable should be one, but there is a chance the dependent variable may be a nominal ordinal interval ratio. So based on the dependent variable, we have to decide which statistics, which regression analysis we have to be adopted. In the case of multiple linear, we need a 2+, so more than two the independent variables needed. So it may be interval or ratio or sometimes dichotomous also. The conditions for dependent variables only one, but it be interval and ratio. So it means a continuous nature. When we can use a logistic regression, so for that two or more independent variables needed. The variable may be interval or ratio or dichotomous in the case of independent variable. But this is important. In the case of dependent variable, our dependent variable should be one, but it should be a dichotomous mode, like binary mode 0, 1 or true or false, that kind of scale it should be there. Now the next is called ordinary regression. So for doing ordinary regression, we need minimum one or more independent variables needed. The independent variable may be a nominal dichotomous. So it's nothing but a categorical variable. But in the case of dependent variable, it should be ordinal data. Then only we can use the ordinal regression. See here, ordinal, ordinal. If the dependent variable is an ordinal, we can go with ordinal. If the dependent variable is a nominal, we can use the logistic regression. The same manner, other regression also there, multinomial regression. So in this case, the assumption is at least one or more independent variable. It may be integral or categorical or dichotomous format is there, but the dependent variable should be nominal. It's like a categorical. The same way, the discriminant analysis also, we need a 1 plus independent variable. It may be integral or ratio, but the dependent variable should be nominal. So this are the condition we can use a different kind of statistical analysis. It was introduced by actually the regression equation or regression. It was introduced by Sir Francis Galton in 1877 in his study of heredity. The term regression has been derived from the word regress, which means the tendency to go back. And normally these two terms is to be technically used to be good while talking about the regression. So the term is nothing but prediction as well as the estimating. Here the main role to find out main role to or main functions of finding using the regression, we can easily predict or estimating the unknown value called dependent value from the values of another variable is known as an independent variable. It means that if you know the value of independent variable, we can predict the value or we can estimate the value of the dependent variable. So for this, we can use this kind of regression. Now I'm going to be lightening, giving this some input later, simple linear regressions. So for doing a simple regressions, we need two variable, x and y. So x is may act as an independent variable. Y is axis is a dependent variable. So that's why x and y is a dependent variable. So sometimes the independent variable, we may use the term as a predictor. The dependent variable, we may use the term as a criterion or a target variable or an output variable. These different terms are there. This is the way the linear regression, simple linear as well, the multilinear is to be differ to each one. For doing a linear regression, we need only one independent in a continuous nature. One dependent in a continuous nature. So it means that one independent, one dependent, we can go with the linear, simple linear. In the case of multiple linear, we need more than one or two, so more than two or more independent variables needed. But the case of dependent variable, only one. But the dependent variable is a continuous nature, but the independent variable may continue as the categorical. So it may be, it's not an, there is no thumb rule for that. But the dependent variable should be in a continuous nature. Next, I'm going to be highlight the regression. I'm going to be highlight the what is the linear regression, how the statement is coming. Suppose in this case, y is a dependent variable, y is a dependent variable, and x is a independent variable. So for this kind of equations, we have to get into finding the regression. Y equal to beta naught plus b1x plus epsilon. So here the y is called as a dependent variable, x is an independent variable. The beta 1 is called as a slope of the coefficients. This is called intercept. Beta 0 is called intercept. Epsilon is called a random residual error or random error. Sometimes we may use the term residual error or random error. So each textbook having the different names are there. Normally the residual error, no, it may be average is 0 only. So in the case of normality, I'm talking. Yeah, now I move to the next slide. This slide shows in the exact picture about this guideline. So in this case, we are going to predict the value of y from the value of x. So because of the reason I'm writing this equation like this. So in this case, the beta 1 represents intercept. So it means, let's see here, if I draw the line, okay, so none of the scores is not below this area, here of this area. Therefore, there's a constantly the scores. None of the scores not lying. Therefore, the scores of y above this general only. Therefore, this area, this is called a constant area. So there the scores not lying. Therefore, it's called beta naught. It's like a constant value. It will differ to the each sample representation or each variable based also. So in this case, the beta naught, this can constant value beta naught for integer case may be different. So what is the b1 beta 1? So this is called the slope of the straight line. This is called the slope of the straight line, that is called beta 1. Then epsilon is nothing but the observed value of y of for x I plus the difference between these two values. So observed value as the predictor value, the difference is called epsilon 1. In this case, our straight line is a predictor straight line. This straight line only I am predict that the scores may lies, but unfortunately the scores lies here only. Therefore, this distance, this is called observed frequency or observed value. This is my predictor value. This difference is called epsilon 1. Therefore, for each data, for each scores, there is the epsilon may be there. For this this course, see here in this here here this epsilon, here it comes, here one epsilon may comes, here the epsilon may comes, here the epsilon may comes. The distance between the observed value and the predictor value is called as a epsilon. So from this only these equations to be generated. Just I move to the next slide. So this slide also showing the same thing, the estimate regression model without the epsilon I writing, because some of the normality property, the epsilon value is to be 0. That's why y equal to b0 plus b1x, the integer random errors terms e1 has the means of 0. If you are summarizing or if you are going to be taken average, the value may be 0 in the case of epsilon. The regression equation or the average value of y is a function of x. So normally we are writing the straight line equation y equal to x plus b. This format I am writing here. Just I'm going to be highlight the simple linear regression, the computation part also. For doing a simple linear regression, so independent variable only one, dependent variable one, but it should be continuous nature. In the case of multiple regression, 2 plus independent variable, dependent variable only one. So in this case only we are using the multiple regression. These are the assumptions we have to think before attempting the regression. So this was the, I'm talking about the linear regression only. The first assumption, the two variables should be measured in a continuous level. So independent variables, dependent variable should be in a continuous nature. The second assumptions, the linear relation between the two variables. So the relationship between the two variables should be linear, not in a curvilinear. That we have to ensure. Then no significant outliers. What is mean significant outliers? See in this case of this diagram. See the, all the scores are scattered around the line only. Here also around. Only few scores, only one score. See, in this case, this score and this score, no? It may lies on a different, otherwise may scatter in different places. But this kind of data, normally it may affect the entire data sets. It may affect the entire data sets. What we have to do? We have to omit this kind of outliers. Otherwise, we have to avoid this kind of outliers. That's why, for before attempting any kind of regression, we have to check any outliers are there. So, the basic things of the assumption is that there is no outliers while adopting the this kind of things. Next assumption, independent of observations. So each observation should be independent to each other. It won't be repeatable, relate to each other. That kind of thing we have to check. Then the fifth assumption, data needs to show homoscedasticity. Homoscedasticity. So what is the homoscedasticity? So this image is showing the homoscedasticity. In this case, so suppose the scores are scattered like this. If I draw a straight line in the center, we may get the two equal parts. So hopefully there is the same chances of the data may spread in the above and below. This is called homoscedasticity. But in the case of heteroscedasticity, see the scores in one area, all the scores may comes like a curve based. So here, see here, all the scores are curve nature. So it may lies in the curve like a parabola. So that one end it may be curved natures. It means that the scores not be scattered parallelly. So if it scatter like this, that is called homoscedasticity. But if you scatter like in a curved manner, that is called heteroscedasticity. So this kind of if you find the heteroscedasticity, we could not be use the regressions and all linear regression. Yes, so now we are discussing about the assumptions. Now I move to the regression equation of x and y is in the form. So in this case, what it means in the sense, if you know the value of x, how we can find out the value of y? Or if you know the value of y, how we can find out the value of x? So the first equation is talking about how we can find out the value of x from y. So it means that x is a dependent variable, y is a independent variable in this case. For this, we can use the formula x minus mx is equal to r is nothing but the relationship between the x and y. Sigma x is called standard deviation divided by standard deviation of y into y is nothing but this cos of y. If you know the values y, you can write the values here. Minus my represent mean of the first mean of the second group. The same way, if you know the value of x, how we can predict the value of y? So in this case, dependent variable is y, independent variable is x. So it means the regression equation of y on x. Otherwise, how we can be find out the value of y from the x? So that is the equation. For this y minus my is equal to r sigma y divided by sigma x into x minus mx. This is the formula we have to use it. Just I'm going to be highlight this the sum also. There is a sum they given as an example. Two achievement tests of max and science are administered for the sample. The following statistics were obtained. So in this case, they are providing the mean, standard deviation, and relationship of x and y. So we can take it as here. This is for the mx. This is for mx. This is for my. It's nothing but mean of the first group, mean of the x, mean of y. This is called sigma x, so standard deviation of first group, sigma y, standard deviation of the y variable. This is called r x comma y. So these things is there, but we have to find out this one. The first one they asking to us, if the science score of student is 40, then you can predict the value of mathematics score. Therefore, they given the value of y. So in this case, y equal to 40. So if the y equal to 40, then they intend to find us, they told us to find out the value of x. So there we are going to find out the value of x from the value of y. Therefore, we can adopt this formula. Regression equation x and y is x and is equal to r of sx minus sy or sigma x divided by sigma y divided into y minus my plus mx. If you substitute the value of r 0.6 and substitute the value of xx 15, and divided by sy into y value 40 is already there in the sum, and my 48 plus mx value 60. Then if you simplify the answer, we are getting the value of x is equal to 54. So what it means? So we are predict the value of x 54 from the value of y. So it means that if the value of y is 40, if one integer getting this course in the science is 40, the particular students, the mark in the mathematics called 54. So this is where we have to predict. Similarly, the second the one, they told if the max scores of another student 70. So they given the scores of x. X is equal to 70 in the case, x is equal to 70. We are going to find out the value of x, sorry, we are going to find out the value of y. That is science mark we have to find. So they given the x value, we have to find the value of y. For this, we can use the formula y equal to r s y divided by x s into x minus mx plus my. So if you substitute the value into like this 0.6 into 12 divided by 15 into 70 minus 60 plus 48. If you simplify this equation, we may get the answer y equal to 52.8. It means that if the value of x is 70, then the value of y should be 52.8. This manner we are predicting. So this is called a regression equation. I hope you understand how we can do it. Now see this case, the important values of regressions. So we already discussed about the assumptions, but when you're doing the SPSS analysis, this kind of assumptions we have to check properly. If you want to check the outliers properties or outliers assumption in the regression, we have to go with standard residual calculation. In the standard regression value, it not be exceeded 3.29. The same if you want to check the independence of observations through the SPSS, the Durbin-Watson scores may be there. In the Durbin-Watson, we have to check the scores won't be exceeded minus 1 to plus 3. So if you're not exceeded, it's called it's not an independence of observation. We could not be used the regression under. Then for finding the multicollinearity of the assumptions, we have the two way we have to check. One is called with the tolerance score, other one is a VFA score. For the tolerance score should be 0.10 or greater, but the VFA score is not greater than 10. So these are the things we have to look while doing SPSS. I'm not talking about SPSS, so very soon I may be give the separate SPSS analysis of regressions I will share you. But this, you have to look on it, this path for reaching the SPSS for doing a regression, analysis regression linear. This finding also, while I'm explaining the SPSS, I may highlight this one. Normally, in the model summary report of the regression, we may get the value for R and R square. R is meant multiple correlation coefficient. R square is called as the amount of variance in the dependent variables. And this is the way we had write the AP score. So while I'm discussing to you in SPSS analysis, I will highlight this also. Normally, there is a relationship between the F and T for the simple linear regressions. F is always is equal to T square. It means that the 2 times of T is equal to F. This is way the F and T is to be related to each other. Then multiple regressions, I am already emphasized that when we can use the multiple regressions, we have more than 2 or more predictor independent variable, only one dependent, we can use multiple regressions. In the multiple regressions, we can go with hierarchical regression also. It will be there in the SPSS. That time I may highlight you our higher order calculation. When you look on the SPSS and SPSS analysis of the regressions, we may get this much of types of the one is called enter method, stepwise method, remove method, backward elimination, and forward selection. Each method is different to each one. So while I'm discussing the SPSS, I may emphasize these things to you. Thank you so much for your patience listening as to the active participant. Hopefully, you may knows how to solve the regressions. I hope you may get more input related to the regressions and its application as well as the assumption. Thank you, Jaybar.